see ya. Pull up a chair by the hearth.
Sorry. Blame my mother. Oh, okay, we're live. Hi, guys.
Hey, what's up? That was seamless.
Yep.
Enjoyed it.
What happened there? Who knows?
Yeah, who knows, Callum? Who knows what happened there? I mean, who knows where to point the finger of blame on that one, Mr. Callum Leslie?
Welcome back, guys! We're here for Show versus Ryzen, and we have the lineups and the ban for you that we can bring you just now. Show, of course, from Team Liquid, Ryzen from Team Complexity, your team Salt. We'll talk about that in just a second. The lineups, we have Paladin, Druid, and Warrior for Show, with Mage being banned. I believe this is going to be our first Paladin we've seen of the day. And Rogue, Paladin, and Druid for Ryzen, with his Warrior being banned.
Yep.
Now, I don't know much about Ryzen, I have to say, but I did see Ryzen in another tournament that I cast with Raven, which is the Dingit Invitational.
Mm.
If you remember way back when we did those tournaments. I think you were in one of them, actually.
I was, yeah.
And Ryzen played in one of them, and that was at the very height of Patron Warrior.
Right.
And everyone brought Patron Warrior except Ryzen, because Ryzen didn't have his Warrior at level 10 on EU.
Interesting. Okay.
But he's now bringing Warrior, so maybe, you know.
Yeah, he's leveled up. He's leveled it up. He's unlocked those, I don't know what Warrior cards you unlock.
Unless he's playing, he might be playing on NA, to be fair.
Yeah, I guess that's true. So, point is, Ryzen is one of those rogue specialists. If you watch his stream, you know, Ryzen is a very, very avid streamer, pretty much a full-time streamer at this point. If you watch his stream, he plays a ton of rogue of all varieties. He's probably played more mill rogue than any other human being alive.
Doesn't sound like something to boast about.
No, probably not. Probably not a thing to put on your CV. World's number one mill rogue player. But yeah, no great surprise that he's brought rogue, but this brings us to the subject of respect bans in ban formats in Hearthstone, which is a phenomenon you encounter sometimes where, say, you run into Zett a lot in tournament. You ban his priest. That's the idea of a respect ban. It's just like, this guy is awesome with this class, I'm going to ban it. It's something that I don't really agree with. I think the idea of respect bans is kind of silly. Because generally, even the very, very best players with a class are only edging out like an extra 2 to 3% win rate with that deck over, you know, an average acceptably good player with the deck. So if you think your lineup is just solid with leaving that deck in, it's probably still more favorable for you to just leave that rogue in Ryzen's lineup, leave the priest in Zetalot's lineup, leave the druid in Tice's lineup. I mean, in that case, you'd ban druid because because Druid's just broken anyway. But, you know, you get the point. So interesting that Sho has gone down that line, chose not to respect the rogue, and just banned out the mage here, which he thinks is just a more solid ban based on his lineup.
Okay, yeah. As you say, you know, the one that was being talked about, the North American preliminaries for the Hearthstone Championship Tour, was like Kit Kats and Warrior, which right. is, you know, Kit Kats likes Warrior, and he does play a lot of Warrior in tournaments, but I wouldn't necessarily say that he's any better than any other Control Warrior player you're going to run into by any considerable margin.
Damn.
Zettel is a good example.
Shots fired at Kit Kats.
Well, no, yeah. I mean, he's definitely good at Control Warrior and experienced, but I'm not sure how much more you can get out of a deck like Control Warrior, if that makes sense.
Right.
Whereas, if you're talking about something like Priest, in a deck that requires maybe a little bit more sideways thinking, if you like.
Sure.
Or Patron, for example, or very strong rogue players.
Yeah.
I would say those are the kind of things you might want to consider for a respect ban. But it's going to be Patron for Sho against, I assume, Oil Rogue for Ryzen. And as you talked about, he is very experienced in this deck. And Sho, another player who's played a ton of Warrior, very respected in that class. And if I remember rightly, Sho was very reluctant and very late to get on the Patron train.
He was, yeah. He was... there was an argument to sticking with the Control Warrior back in the Warsong Patron days, because Control Warrior was the best counter to Patron Warrior. Probably even better than Handlock, in my opinion, even though most people went to the Handlock overall because it was a better deck against the field. So there was a relevant kind of thing where if you weren't a top-tier Patron player, bringing Control Warrior wasn't bad, but yeah, eventually even Sho came around to the light side of the Grim Patrons.
And even now, when Patron isn't so insidious and all-dominating, you see Sho playing Patron here, so definitely a departure from where he was even sort of 6 to 8 months ago.
Indeed. So not a great deal to do here for Sho. Just going to armor up pass, but again, he'll be fine with that situation. This is a little bit different from the Control Warrior matchup. We talked about that beforehand, where Control Warrior just tries to survive, exhaust all the threats of the rogue, leave them kind of helpless. This is a much more tempo-focused matchup where both players are kind of fighting for the board once things start going off. Both decks are a little bit slow to start up, because both decks kind of rely a little bit on removing the opponent's stuff in the early turns with, you know, weapons, slams, kind of stuff like that. And then from the rogue side, you know, you're daggering up, you want to like SI7 something early on, you want to hit something with a deadly poison early. So it takes a few turns for this matchup to get started, but once it does get started, it tends to explode very quickly, because both of these decks are capable of like some of the biggest swing turns on the board of any two decks in Hearthstone.
Yeah, I was going to ask before we saw it from Sho what you thought generally and in this matchup about the turn 3 Frothing Berserker.
I mean, without the Warsong in the deck anymore, turn 3 is pretty much the best turn for the Frothing Berserker these days. You can use it to, in the late game, which would make a huge tempo play on the same turn as Lothed, for example. You know, get a big whirlwind turn, clear out a couple of minions, get like a 10 damage Frothing in play, and then jam Lothed alongside it and try and use that as a win condition. But generally, most matchups, you'll be happy to jam that thing down, especially when you have a weapon to back it up, like this situation. So you can now just hack down that Shredder, and you just have this nice consolidated Frothing Berserker that can trade or go face based on whatever you think the situation is here.
Ooh. I was going to say, if there was a one health Shredder drop, the Whirlwind would be an interesting proposition.
Yeah.
But maybe not this one health Shredder drop.
I think if the Whirlwind, Captain's Parrot or Novice Engineer or something had happened there, I think you'd still hold and aim to maybe Whirlwind it next turn. Would protect your Frothing Berserker from Deadly Poison, but it's a pretty low value Whirlwind overall, so you'd try and like play Acolyte next turn and Whirlwind to clear out the board that way, get an even bigger buff on the Frothing. But yeah, the Explosive Sheep was actually pretty good for Ryzen in that situation. Gave him a nice clean clear on the Frothing.
Absolutely. It has a Shredder to back it up. His second Shredder, which gets eaten by the second half of the Fiery War Axe, the synergy between the two. That's a little bit better drop for Ryzen for controlling the board.
Yep, but still not really good enough to contest this Shredder, but the deadly poisons in hand are going to have an effect. But yeah, I was going to say, just Sludge Belcher, natural predator of the pilot Shredder here, just comes down, makes the Shredder's life awkward, protects the 2-3 from the favorable trade, so big fan of that. But look, he'll be looking to get that deadly poison up relatively soon, I think. He might just even conceal both poisons in his hand, just not reveal the fact that he has one. Because that situation makes your opponent feel a little bit more brave about going for the all-in patron play at some point, if that's what his hand is, especially now this Death Spite is up. So he has a number of turns here. He can choose to just curve out with the Drake. He can play Lotheb now that he sees the threat of the Death Spite to prevent the patron play. But of course, that involves exposing your Lotheb to the second charge of Death Spite, which doesn't feel particularly good. Or you can just kind of load up the deadly poison here, try and go down that line. But yeah, I like the Drake. Probably means he's now obligated to trade into the Shredder, though, maybe? Hard to say.
I was going to say, Saul, before, when the Sludge Belcher was there and before the Drake came down, what do all the cards in play right now have in common? We're not going to see any of them in a little while. Because standard.
All right, that's not bad. Chooses to go with the prep fan just for a bit of tempo, enables him to get the full clear down here. And it looks like he's considering how aggressive he'd like to be here. It seems like the answer is very aggressive.
Yeah, I mean, if he'd got something that he could clear up and keep the Shadow Boxer alive, I think he would almost have definitely made the trade. Now we see a classic warrior power play, Death Spite onto Armorsmith and Acolyte.
Yep.
It's one of the classics that Warrior likes to bring out, no matter whether it's control or patron.
For sure, and there is the patron coming into hand, but again, we see the fact that Ryzen has so far concealed these deadly poisons, so we might be about to see the all-in patron play coming down soon. It's gonna go with the Violet Teacher SI play here, taking out the Violet Teacher. Still, those deadly poisons are just being held in hand, and now with two patrons in hand, we're probably more than likely to see one come down this turn.
He can it's Cruel Taskmaster, Whirlwind, and the Unstable Go, so
right.
That's so a full board of patrons.
He can play patron, he can trade into the 3-3, and then he doesn't even have to do it that way if he doesn't want to. No, that's still the best, and he probably ends up just executing the Violet Teacher. But yeah, Ryzen's a little, I don't know whether he's done this deliberately or whether his hand has just lined up that way, but the fact that the deadly poisons have remained concealed is gonna pay out here, because he's gonna be able to clear out this first wave of patrons, but there is a second one, at least with a Cruel Taskmaster, to follow it up fairly quickly.
Yeah, but anytime you can clear up a board full of patrons in a fairly clean one-turn way,
yeah,
that's gonna feel pretty good. Now, maybe not as much as before, when clearing the board of patrons against the charging patron deck was a lot more of a threat, but these ones are still a problem. And what do you do after you clear them out here? You can't really do anything, can you?
Can't do anything, no.
So
interestingly enough, you have to hit the Armorsmith here instead of going face. It actually does more damage, right? You miss 3 damage, he gains 1 armor. The alternative is that you deal 3 damage, he gains 5 armor. So yeah, it's actually more damage to just deadly poison down the Armorsmith, which is kind of annoying, but needs must.
Yeah, you saw Ryzen initially will go, well, of course I go face here before I Blade Flurry, and then think about it. You go, actually, I think I need to do it the other way around. The Lotheb is going to be a bit of a problem for Ryzen here, because you'd think that Sprint would have looked like a really good option this turn.
Would. He can play the counter Lotheb here, which would lock out most high tempo plays here that don't involve the two Lothebs trading. Unfortunately for him, he still has that available to him with the Cruel Taskmaster, and Cruel Taskmaster Battle Rage does not look like a terrible turn here if he wants to go down that line. But it looks like he's just going to go with the Patron Cruel Taskmaster, and that means he probably is going to end up trading the 2/5/5 to keep the Frothing Berserker on board. Yeah, I like this much better. Your Frothing Berserker gain already grows into a 5/4 anyway, so this is a much better line of play from Sho.
Yeah, that Frothing Berserker starting to look very threatening, but there is the Blade Flurry and the second poison.
Yeah.
So he can hit the Frothing Berserker and then poison and clear the board. He has given up in both of his Blade Flurries.
Right. But he's used both of his blade flurries on both waves of patrons, which is kind of what they're allocated for in the deck. You probably won't feel the need to blade flurry again after this.
And the second Frothing Berserker as well.
And the second Frothing Berserker, yeah. So most of the threatening minions have been used here for show, and this is one of those weird quirks of Hearthstone where the play that immediately jumped out to me of using the Battle Rage this turn on Sho's previous turn, I totally agree that the line that Sho saw is a better play. But in this situation, it actually would have worked out better to do my line because this Battle Rage would have drawn him two cards last turn. So, you know, it's one of those weird quirks of Hearthstone where, you know, making the best play every turn does not always win you the game. It's about making the play that wins you the game most often. That's kind of the definition of the best play. But this is just one of those weird situations where the best play actually puts Sho in a worse situation than a less good play.
Yep, does pick up that Doctor Boom, so he is going to be able to get some board presence back next turn, but it gives Ryzen a really good turn to be able to skip playing a lot of things on the board or a lot of spells and get that sprint in now. Don't think he really wants to do anything else here either.
No. He's going to have Abyss Face just to spend the mana. That's interesting. With the second Abyss in hand, so he's probably counted lethal here, so 17... Next turn, if the 3-2 stays alive, which it won't due to the execute pickup, but he would have had 4 plus 6 is 10. It would have still been a little short. Interesting. But that execute pickup is actually huge because it stops the really clean trade of the 3-1, the 3-2 and the Eviscerate into the Dr. Boom. So,
yeah, I think you could tell from Ryzen's reaction, it was a small reaction, but you could tell I think that was what he was trying to line up, was some kind of big power play and to be able to get at least close to lethal.
Yeah.
Just that 3-2 still alive.
Yeah, just be aggressive, keep a minion on the board, be able to bank your Tinker's Oil on the following turn. Would have made a lot of sense. You'd have been pushing really, really close to lethal, but now we're in that sad situation where we either have to backstab Eviscerate the Dr. Boom and still face tank 7, or we can just choose to sap it and be in that miserable 4 boom bot world that every rogue player has experienced once or twice. But it looks like, is there going to be a sap play here? Looks like he is just going to go for the aggressive line here. Follow this up with the sap, yep. Interesting.
I mean, when you've used both your blade flurries, I think that there's definitely a merit to thinking that what damage you have left has to go to face. Because you've used two poisons, two flurries.
Right.
And I think that's part of the reason why the Abyss went face. Because he knows that he has a very, very limited pool of damage but now available to him. Mm-hmm. And he's against a warrior.
Yep, no, for sure. I think there is still a few minions left in the deck that he can still build a board presence with, but this is the point where Patron Warrior is starting to recover. He got to that situation where he was out of cards, had used all his threats, just had a Battle Rage sat in hand, but the Acolyte of Pain is starting to get some real work done here, starting to refill his hand. And gets the full ball clear with the boom bots, and now Ryzen straight back in that same situation he found himself in last turn.
And picks up another sap to do it with, yeah.
Nice.
Okay. 6 boom bot game. That's my kind of game of Hearthstone. Yeah, now the Acolyte, and we talked about the dire situation he was in, whirlwinding on an Acolyte, but it was just enough to keep him, to get him to the point he is in his deck now, and to keep him alive in the game, but he is down to 4 health now.
He is, but he can armor back up to 6. He can armor back up to more than 6, in fact. And the Unstable Ghoul as well, with both saps gone, is going to at least tank the weapon from the damage. The damage from the weapon, sorry, that comes in next turn. So even though he's at a pretty fragile position, like you said, we've now seen both Eviscerates. We've seen both Blade Flurries. So the options for dealing damage past Taunt are quite low. On top of that, we've already seen both saps being used, so this Unstable Ghoul is a pretty big wall here.
Yeah, it's really going to help him to potentially close this out, and I mean, the Boombots did pretty well as well, getting him down to 10. Put Sho in a pretty good position for potential lethal, and it actually does make his decision-making a little bit more difficult, because getting his opponent to 10, playing the Boom becomes perhaps slightly more attractive, because you're putting a lot of damage on the board to potentially get pretty close to lethal the next turn.
Yep. I guess he's just calculating his opponent's exact outs here, and I guess he's come to the conclusion that the top deck is at least very, very unlikely to be able to kill him. But we are literally needing two damage, in fact, from the rogue. Did he have time to cast the Inner Rage? No, I think that Inner Rage almost certainly would have been cast if he'd have had time and didn't rope out there just to pick up the potential for the one extra armor, but two damage needed here. I'm not sure what he can draw. I think both SIs have been used as well, if I'm not mistaken.
I think you're right. I wouldn't want to bet on it, but yes.
Unfortunately,
so draw cards.
Yeah, but like Fan into SI in theory is lethal here, but with that Armorsmith on the board, casting Fan will just immediately grant his opponent four more armor, so we're in a bit of a rough spot here.
Yeah, I don't know if you can even play the Fan here, right?
I don't think so.
I think you just have to wait. But are you dead if you do it? You are dead if you do that because of the Inner Rage. But without the Inner Rage, if it's with what's on board, you're not quite dead, but yeah.
He's gonna go ahead and do it. Sho gets a little bit of a smile spreading across his face. Blood Mage is not gonna get the job done, and the Boombot damage to face is enough to seal the game, even without the Inner Rage that we see in Sho's hand. So, well played to Sho there. Patron Warrior goes out to a 1-0 lead in this matchup.
Yeah, disappointing for Ryzen to lose with his Rogue in the very first game here. We've seen 6-0 get the win with his Rogue in that early game in that series that really set the tone and gave him that advantage, which really paid off in the end when he won that series 3-2 with his favorite deck, one of his favorite decks. And with Ryzen, that very much is his specialist deck, the Rogue. So it's going to be a little blow for him to lose that.
Yeah, very much so. Of course, I talked at length that Ryzen is primarily a Rogue player. It's what you see the most if you go to check out his stream. So he'll definitely be a little bit down to lose that Rogue. And he's going to have to fight back now with the decks that he's a little less known for, but he has some good options in here. His Warrior has been banned, leaving him with Druid and Paladin. So if you're going to have two decks in your arsenal, Callum, that can just curve out and beat up on some opponents and bring you back from behind, Druid and Paladin are two pretty good options.
Yeah, I'm going to be honest. If I was playing in a tournament, those are the two decks I would play. That's because I'm a brainless moron Hearthstone player. What do we have left for Sho? Is the Paladin, the Warrior, and the... Was it the Mage banned or the Druid banned?
Mage was banned.
Right. So he has the Paladin and Druid as well.
Yep.
And it's all about his Warrior. So I guess in some ways it's about what work the Warrior can get done here.
Right. And the Warrior can potentially get a lot of work done here because it's slightly favored against the Druid, somewhere between like 51 and 55%, depending on who you talk to. And it's very, very much favored against Secret Paladin. You know, Unstable Ghouls, Armorsmiths early on, Fiery War Axe controlling the board, and then you have the ability to, any time before they challenger, so turn 6, which is the turn when every Secret Paladin casts Mysterious Challenger, if you're able to get ahead of that with a Grim Patron play, the game pretty much ends on the spot, because Paladin has no way to fight back against that. So Patron Warrior, definitely one of the best answers to Secret Paladin, does pretty well against Druid as well, so I'm going to possibly put my neck on the line here. I don't want to curse my Complexity teammate here, but this could be the first one of those 3-0s that we said was very, very possible to come up in Last Hero Standing.
Well, we do see Ryzen is going to pick the Druid, and as you said, it's slightly favored against the Druid, the Warrior.
Yeah,
you would say.
Yeah, I think actually, I mean, 55 may be about right. A few players might even say that it's a little bit higher than that. 51's probably a little bit low, but it's one of the few matchups that I think may have actually benefited from the new mid-range build of Patron, in that it's actually better against Druid now than it used to be. Mm. Because the extra things like, you know, potentially Piloted Shredders, Frothing Berserker was already a minion that you played out on curve against Druid anyway. Like, you just jammed it on turn 3 in the matchup. And the core of the win condition hasn't changed, which is just get patrons as early as possible. But these extra tempo cards, like the Dread Corsairs, Piloted Shredder, Sludge Belcher, any of that stuff that you have in the deck, all those kind of things are like more effective against Druid than just all the little combo pieces that you had before. So
I do enjoy my cliched Hearthstone wisdom, and one of the pieces around the heyday of Patron was, as you say, that you win against Druid by putting a board full of patrons, because it's very, very difficult for Druid, more difficult than any other class, to be able to deal with that.
Yep, one of the classes that struggles the most, for sure. They do have some options, but it generally involves your hand being Emperored and it being very specific. you know, you need to tie together like a combination of maybe Drake, Living Roots, and Swipe that have all been hit by Emperor Thorasan or something crazy like
that. It's not like Warlock where you can just rip Hellfire.
Yeah, exactly.
If you were when you were playing Handlog, it's not like you had Hellfire and Shadow Flame and all those things, or you have Flame Strike and the like.
Exactly. But it does come down to early hands a little bit in this matchup. Early minions are great for the warrior, as is Deathspite and any additional pieces of the Grim Patron combo if you have the coin. Druid is just looking for general druid things in this matchup, more or less. Just hit the ramp, hit those strong aggressive minions early, try and get Shredder and Druid of the Claw down as early as you can and go from there. And just try and be as aggressive as possible. Put the patron on as small a clock as you can. Limit the amount of turns they have to draw the combo pieces.
And limit the board development of the patron as well. I mean, we've seen from both 6-0 and Show the impact that you can have being able to develop the slightly slower, less aggressive minions on board, like Acolyte, Armorsmith, and the Dread Corsairs as well. If you can rule those options out and say, when you have to play a weapon to deal with my stuff, or you have to execute or slam rather than play those minions, you can really hurt them in the later game as well.
Yep, absolutely. So looking at the mulligans here, Sho is staring long and hard at this double fiery war axe hand, debating whether
I think he might be frozen.
It's more interesting to say that he just cannot possibly decide how many of these fiery war axes.
Sho is staring deep into my soul right now.
He is. Can we get some Sho pride in chat right now?
That's a piercing stare.
It is. I hope he hasn't disconnected, because it seems like, it looks like he just kept Dr. Boom double fire. Yeah, I think we might have some connection issues here with Sho, because that is not a hand that you're going to keep. So I'm guessing his mulligan just timed out, which is a little bit disappointing. So we may have a rapid end to this game, or not so rapid as we wait for Sho's first turn to rope out here. But it looks like there are some connection issues from Sho's side. We've lost his Skype, and he's roped out on the mulligan. No response here from the first phone. Yeah.
So we'll just, our production team will sort that out. We apologize for the interruption. These things do happen. I mean, we're living in the interconnected esports age. It's one of the great things about esports is that you can, play from all over the world and have broadcasts produced from another part of the world while casters are in another part of the world. But it does lead to things like this, unfortunately. Hopefully it's nothing sinister. It's just a small connection blip on Sho's end, and we'll get you back into that game as quickly as possible. But yeah, we talked already, I think, in detail about the Patron Warrior Druid matchup and how you think it's slightly favored for the Druid. Patron. Against the Druid.
Mm-hmm.
If Sho is able to go out to a 2-0 lead here, mm-hmm. Ryzen's going to have to come back with the Paladin. Paladin, a very debated deck. But do you think it has the ability to come back against everything Sho's packing?
Oh, it has the ability to beat anything, for sure. Like, the God Curve, what having a deck with a curve that consistent does is it means if your opponent draws badly, you punish them, like, 90% of the time you have the curve to hurt them afterwards. But the problem is that if he loses this game, his Paladin immediately goes back into Patron Warrior, which is one of the decks where there are very, very few combinations of, early game cards after a good mulligan from someone who knows what they're doing that don't line up well. You know, the number of cards that are good in your opening hand, or at least potential to be good. Two Fiery War Axes, two Armorsmiths, two Unstable Ghouls. Cruel Taskmaster we saw in Sho's deck is fine as well.
I think is it just one Cruel Taskmaster?
It should just be one. Two is very rare, but even having a Whirlwind against Muster for Battle is good. Deathspite is fine to have. Grim Patron and Inner Rage, if you have those two cards together, that's fine to have as well. So that's like half your deck already that you can potentially have in your opening hand to feel relatively comfortable against Mysterious Challenger Paladin. So it's going to be an uphill struggle if he does lose this game. I think his series really does hinge on being able to clutch this one out.
Yeah, I remember the conversations we had about Paladin when we last cast a big tournament together, which was the HS Arena tournament, the 6-0-1. We were casting with Firebat. I think it was Firebat who was most vociferous about this out of the three of us, that his problem with Secret Paladin wasn't the mysterious Challenger. It was the fact that Paladin just has the best minion in every slot. And it was the Paladin deck that was doing really well in that tournament was the kind of slightly slower zombie Chow
with
Paladin.
Chows, right? Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So, not only were you taking the standard curve of the shielded mini ball into Muster, into Shredder, and then into, you know, your mysterious challenger, Boom, Tyrion. Actually, what they were playing was Zombie Chow, shielded mini ball, Muster, but also Aldor Peacekeeper. And then into your Shredder, and then into likely Lotheb or a Belcher at five. You know, Belcher and Lotheb, probably the two best five drops in the game, maybe Azdrake as well, but yeah, two of the best. Into your mysterious challenger, into Boom, into Tyrion. And the amount of times we saw, you know, 80% of that curve come out on time is disgusting. And I remember playing after that tournament, playing that deck, and it seemed almost unreasonable the number of times you would draw Zombie Chow in your opening hands.
Right. And that's kind of the problem with, like, when a mid-range curve deck goes up against a mid-range curve deck. If you're just drawing and playing stat-for-stat minions each turn, then the class that has the better stuff available to them just has this unnatural advantage. That's what Paladin has. One of the reasons why Grim Patron can fight back against this is that it's not a deck that just follows the power to mana curve each turn. Mm-hmm. You know, it can play an Armorsmith on two or an Unstable Ghoul on two, which is not an individually hugely powerful minion compared to a shielded minibot. The thing is, like, after that, you then hide an Acolyte of Pain behind your Unstable Ghoul. You Cruel Taskmaster something so that you get additional tempo. Like, you're doing these flexible things that, when combined together, just break apart that normal power curve that the Paladin has. And that's why it's so powerful overall, because basically you can pick two cards out of the deck and say, do these, like, combine together well against Secret Paladin? And the answer is probably yes.
Just to give you guys an update, Shaw has got back online. It's clearly just a minimal problem. So we're just getting him set back up again, getting that match set back up. And we'll jump into that as soon as we can. Good. See, there hopefully wasn't any kind of more serious problem. We wouldn't want to see anything like that happen. We want to see these guys go at it, and I'm excited, particularly given Shaw's, you know, 1-0 up and in a good position against the Druid. You know, this could be a very dominant performance for Shaw, and going into our top 8 tomorrow, these guys, you know, you only get to play one match on the first day, which I think is an interesting dynamic in this kind of 16-man tournament. So you only play one match and then set yourself up for potentially three the next day. So how much information you give away, what kind of momentum you get for yourself, what kind of impression you leave on the field. You only have one opportunity to do that.
Right, for sure. Playing one game in a day is kind of a frustrating experience. I know it's something that I've had in a number of different scenarios, not just the one that you're giggling at right now, Callum. Not just that one. But
I'm thinking about four that I'm giggling at,
okay,
to be honest.
Fair enough. But the experience of just, like, you're in a tournament where you're only supposed to play one game a day, like either in a league format or this sort of format where it's a 16-man split up over a couple of days. You know, building yourself up just to play one series and then you kind of have to crash and unwind after that and do it all again the next day. It's a hard thing to, like, to manage, you know, emotionally and preparation-wise. It's a hard thing to get yourself up for that over and over again, so... definitely, like, hats off to these players that are doing it, and you know, commiserations, I guess, to the people that just crash out immediately, and that's all they have to show for their presence in the Wombology Invitational.
It's a lot of sitting around and waiting as well.
Yeah.
You know, particularly if you're in sort of the third quarter of the pack, because at the end you kind of, you know, you can leave a long time before you check in and, you know, get ready because you're right at the end. If you're at the beginning, you're kind of okay, but those people. It's you know, it's too awkward to maybe go do something beforehand or, you know, really do anything with your afternoon. It's also fair to say, you know, the time zones for some of these players, it's not that late in the US, and Ryzen being based there, you know, sort of a Jordan as well. Some of these guys might be your typical nocturnal gamers, and maybe this is a little bit early for them to get up. But we are getting back into the game here, and as I say, it's going to be the Druid against the Warrior of Shaw. We're back. So Frothy Berserker for Shaw. Do you think that's something you might keep in the mulligan?
I think one might get kept here, yeah. Looks like one is being kept. Definitely a better card to have with the coin. Coin 3/3 is something that happens quite often in this matchup. But there's a lot of powerful openings here. You like to have Deathbite, but even things like Unstable Ghoul and then hide an Acolyte behind it the next turn can be pretty powerful. But this handful of reasonable minions here from Shaw he's not going to be too sad about, but... he's going to need to pick up some form of removal at some point in the near future, preferably in the form of Deathbite. From Ryzen's side, handful of ramp, and I was about to say not really anywhere to go with it, but now we play Dr. Boom next turn.
Yeah, interesting bit of trivia, Sottle. Obviously, we haven't got Shaw's webcam back, but we do have a picture of Shaw. Mm-hmm. What team is he playing for on that picture?
Is that a Dignitas hoodie?
Is indeed. It's from Sho's previous StarCraft 2 career when he was on Team Dignitas.
Really? I did not know that.
There you go.
Fascinating.
Some facts for you, some trivia. Yeah. So you don't just get Hearthstone casting here, you just get general esports knowledge.
Beautiful stuff, Callum. Ryzen chose to respect the multiple card drawer of the Acolyte there, passed up a turn 3 Doctor Boom in order to silence the Acolyte of Pain, which is a very disciplined play, to say the least. But, you know, he's scared. There's a lot of potential draws for Execute if it's not already in the hand, if he leaves that Acolyte up against the Boombots. So, you know, I guess I can get on board with this play, but I'm a big fan of if you get to play Dr. Boom on a stupid turn. It's not as if, like, turn 7 is already stupid enough to be able to play Dr. Boom. If you can play it on an idiotic turn like turn 3, I'm usually a big fan of making that happen.
I feel like this is... It's kind of okay also because he has the coin and the innervate. It's not like we're talking about turn 5 passing on just an innervate in hand.
Mm-hmm.
Because if he wants, he can just innervate it out on turn 5. And that's still, you know, that's still a great power play to be able to get Dr. Boom out on turn 5. And that's what he's going to do here. I thought he might think again about that, having picked up the Azure Drake, but it's still a very good play. So you still get to play Dr. Boom early, and you get to deny the power of the card draw. In the last game, it was the double Acolyte play that really cost.
Yeah, for sure. So it looks like Sho is going to jam down the Frothing Berserker here just to try and get something competitive in play to deal with this Dr. Boom. Going to Inner Rage, trade in, and just face tank the 7 damage this turn. In fact, he's going to go for the all-in trade and just leave that Frothing Berserker against the Boombots. Just hope it lives. I mean, I guess this is the best answer he had. If he left it up, it was going to take 7 to the face anyway, so he might as well tank the 7 on his terms, get it off the board. But those Boombots are probably going to get some work done here, and Ryzen is just going to be able to keep on developing.
Yeah, I mean, even in worst-case scenario, Ryzen can play the Keeper of the Grove and clear it up. Or even the swipe if he wanted to do that. But the Keeper of the Grove is all that's required. As you say, it would stop him being able to develop anything on the board, but it's not a scary proposition. I think, is he thinking about maybe keeping the Boombot alongside the Keeper here?
Yeah, so if he, it's exactly 50-50 if he attacks it as to whether he gets to clear it or not. So it's a 50-50 balance of being able to develop a Shredder or a Drake instead of the Keeper and not having a Boombot, or having this board here where you still have a Boombot in play. So making the safe play there doesn't even really sacrifice too much board presence when you think about it, depending on how highly you evaluate having a Boombot in play. I don't mind the safe play there after the results of the first Boombot. Just chooses to keep his second Boombot in play. Can now use it this turn to be able to control some of this Sludge Belcher. Interesting that Sho decided not to respect the Boombot. He could have axed it down before playing the Belcher that turn if he wanted.
I think there is a lot of merit to keeping the Boombot. You know, you talk about how, depending on how highly you regard keeping a Boombot in play generally.
Yeah.
In this matchup, keeping a Boombot in play, actually pretty relevant in a number of cases. You know, if Sho were to play, for example, Grim Patron Whirlwind, and your patron died to the Boombot, that's a thing that can happen.
Yeah, but a thing that can also happen is that it just hits another patron and spawns another one.
That's also true.
It's not necessarily good for you to have Boombots in play when patron things happen. In fact, sometimes when you're that far behind on the board, and Dr. Boom comes down, you just kind of YOLO the patrons to try and get yourself back into it with a Whirlwind and see if you can get lucky off the Boombot. So sometimes it's a comeback mechanism for your opponent. But speaking of comeback mechanisms, Dr. Boom is taken out by the Big Game Hunter, and Ryzen is in a pretty comfortable position here. He has the follow-up combo here. I don't really see any play that is going to dig Sho out of trouble here. And since he just commits to the Grom, there is going to be no protection from that combo. And we spoke at length, due to the delay, Callum, at the start, about how important it was for him to get the patron out of the series right here and now. And he manages to do that. Turn 9 combo, got exactly what he wanted. Early ramp into mid-range minions, into combo. Druid 101, levels up the series now, 1-1.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, that would have taken it to 2-0, and 2-0 is always hard to come back from. But I think that really would have been the turning point in this series that would have tilted it away from Ryzen. And at 1-1, he has a very fair chance of getting back into it. It's, in fact, very much a fair fight, if you like, and depending how these line up, because it's Druid and Paladin versus Druid and Paladin.
Right. We are going to have some 50-50 matchups coming up here.
What do you favor, Subtle Druid or Druid? Paladin or Paladin?
Well, I mean, the slight difference here is that Sho gets to pick which of these matchups he wants to play first.
He's picking the Paladin.
He's picking Paladin. So he can choose from his perspective how he feels about the Paladin-Druid matchup. And I guess he feels like it's better than 50-50. Or he has a Druid deck which is unfavored in the mirror, maybe by playing things like Harrison Jones in there. Mm-hmm. So he kind of gets a little bit of an advantage by being able to navigate this series in the way that he would like. He gets to pick the favorable matchup now. So if he wins this game with Paladin, which he obviously feels he's slightly favored to do, having chose it over a 50-50 matchup, then he only has to win a 50-50 mirror match afterwards. Unless this is any Finn Paladin, but I find that incredibly unlikely because he's just picked it into mid-range Druid.
I was going to say this. A, he's picked into Druid. B, we're watching Sho, not Nevs. Yeah. So any Finn Paladin. Any Finn Paladin is horrible. I really hate that deck.
What? Deck's so fun.
I mean, it is fun to play. It's fun to play. It's not just not fun to play against.
No, that's very true.
It's really horrible to play against.
Yeah.
And funnily enough, that was almost the entire justification for Blizzard nerfing Grim Patron. It wasn't the win rate. It wasn't how successful it was. It was just it wasn't fun. So, it wasn't fun to play against.
All right, Callum. Gale.
Just saying, I'm just saying, anything is next on the chopping block.
How's the view from up there, Mr. Leslie?
Incorrect nerf calls, Callum Leslie.
Yeah. All right.
Well, double two drops here for the Paladin.
Yep.
That sounds good.
Double two drop and a challenger in hand. I looked away from the mulligan briefly. He had a challenger in his mulligan and ended up with a challenger, which suggests that he kept it. It's possible that he threw it away and got back the second one. But
yes, it's not always super obvious in the Observer overlay, so I'm not convinced what we saw there. But yeah, he does have a challenger in his opening hand.
But there's definitely a decent amount of debate still about which matchups it's right to keep it in, how much of an effect does having the coin in your hand. You know, some people are just like, no, you keep challenger in every matchup ever. Like,
I remember when Secret Paladin first came out, right after TDT came out, we were at Insomnia Land in the UK, and it was literally like the days after TGT came out, right? It came out on the Thursday and the tournament was Friday through Sunday.
Yeah.
And in the tournament, on one of the side tournaments on the Sunday, I played Secret Paladin and beat quite a lot of people I had no right beating because they hadn't seen it yet.
Big surprise!
Yeah, but a UK player, Pesty, was also on the Secret Paladin train quite early and said, and I asked him, you know, when do you keep challenger? And he said, every time.
Yeah.
Every single time.
Yeah.
Because then you just win.
Yep. But anyway, he has kind of run out of steam a little bit here on his turn 3, forced to go for a hero power secret turn. It's competitive spirit, which gets him a nice buff on a couple of minions here, but he's running out of pressure a little bit. Might just be forced to keep Revolver Man this bear and still double trade in. Would leave him with a 3-4 and 2 1-1s against an empty board. Like that's what we're going for. Could have just Iron Beaked Owled it, slammed another hero power, gone face, but probably better to address the minion that's in front of you here. And still leaves him ahead on the board, but he's gonna have to deal with the exact same situation over again, unless the swipe comes off the top.
Oh, wow. That's a little disgusting.
It is, but I mean, honestly, I kind of don't hate the Druid of the Claw there instead, because you put 6 health on the board against 5 power. Whereas swiping just hands back initiative to your opponent to develop a minion. Guess what Secret Paladin wants to do on every single turn of the game, Callum? It's develop a free minion.
And then you're letting them develop a minion ahead of turn 6.
Exactly.
And Mysterious Challenger plays better with friends, despite not being very friendly in how he introduces himself, because of things like Avenge and Redemption and the like. So allowing your opponent to develop a minion ahead of a potential challenger turn makes the challenger all that more effective. I do still somewhat long for the early days of playing Secret Paladin, when you basically won with Secret Paladin by playing the Mysterious Challenger, putting up a ton of secrets, and your opponent going, there are lots of secrets, yeah. I do not know what to do.
Yeah.
What are the Paladin secrets? Yeah. I can't remember, I don't play Arena, I can't remember what the Paladin secrets are.
Gets the Avenge buff onto the Mysterious Challenger here, so the Big Game Hunter is going to be activated, but he had a pretty much win-win situation there, because if the Avenge had gone onto the Piloted Shredder, he could have just silenced off both buffs, the Death Rattle, the Avenge buff and the Death Rattle, and then just traded clean with the Druid of the Claw. Sure, that would have left a 6-6 behind instead of a Piloted Shredder, but whichever target the Avenge hit there, he had a really good answer in hand for it. But he does still get the slightly better of the two options and puts Ryzen in a pretty solid position here.
Yeah, this is a really good position for Ryzen. If you can, anytime you can deal with a Mysterious Challenger that efficiently and still come away with a really good board yourself, you're in a pretty great position. Now we are actually going to see the silence on the Druid of the Claw.
Yeah.
Which we could have seen, what, 3-4 turns ago now?
Yeah, I think it's much more effective there than it was the previous turn, though. It's not just a silence to just go face and try and win the game through smork damage. He just needed to get that taunt effect out of the way so he could pick up the value trade on the board. So that seems like a much more reasonable use of the owl, and he's pretty much rewarded for holding on to it there.
And some nice draws for Ryzen here. Getting the double Azure Drake to get through his deck a little bit. Maybe get a Savage Roar. That's exactly what I was looking at there.
Now he's going to innovate the hero power now that he picked up the innovate. I think if he didn't get the innovate off the first Drake, we would have seen just break hero power and shade that turn, just to be able to address the board. But the Avenge here is going to give a decent buff to one of these Shredders, but this is a huge board that needs dealing with the threat of a Savage Roar in hand. Second Challenger will not pull a Noble Sacrifice, but the second Noble Sacrifice is in hand, so he does at least have a tournament attendee, I guess, here, right? 2-1 taunt. But that, I don't think is going to get the job. Oh, that helps. Okay.
Yeah, that's a really good thing. The Blue Gill Warrior to kill the Big Game Hunter.
Yeah, that's awesome. Holy crap. Piloted Shredder, what a card. You will be sorely missed.
No secrets. Only had double Avenge and double Noble Sack.
So his list is double Avenge, double Noble Sack, one Redemption, and one Competitive Spirit in terms of secrets. Which,
correct.
As you said,
six secrets.
Yeah, is low on the secret count. You know, 6 to 9 is usually what you're looking at. 9 is on the extreme end, 6 on the low end. Some of the lists, like the old school list we talked about before, only play 4, like one copy of each with the zombie chows. But that's mostly cycled out of vogue at this point.
I feel like I'm not even sure. Yeah, wait, was it only one copy of each, or was there?
Yeah.
I think, yeah, it was the one copy of those four.
Yeah.
But that Lothab there, locking down a lot of options for the boards. She only has 2 cards here. Can't do the Knife Juggler Muster. You can see the frustration, and the Savage Roar is still threatening.
Yeah, so let's say...
Actually, what he has to do the Muster for Battle here, right? To survive.
So if he trades... And he'll go down to 8, and there'll be... No, he's still dead, even if he musters.
Well, if he'd mustered and killed the Azure Drake, he'd
be... Yeah, he still dies. He still dies. 3+4+1.
Oh, right, yeah, the hero power.
Yeah.
That's okay. I'm just, you know, I have to check these things.
Yeah.
Whoa. That's how this works. I'm the dumb one, I ask you the questions. Mm-hmm. Ryzen drawing for some reason.
Well, he didn't face tank. He played the juggler and he got the juggle, so he didn't face tank the Drake.
Oh, right, yeah.
So he's actually not got lethal here. So the Ancient of Lore makes perfect sense. Living Roots to take it out, and Hero Power takes down the 6-1 most likely. Yep. Back in the same situation, Sho is going to have to keep finding defensive answers every single turn, and this is not a deck that plays a great deal of them. So,
yeah, the problem he has with the double Savage Roar is the turn coming up with this shade. The shade's going to be at 4, and that's going to be more than enough just with the shades and the shade and the Savage Roar. So,
yep, Ryzen starting to feel it just a little bit, moving back and forward in his chair, gives a little salute here. Double Savage Roar going to seal out the game. Probably just see the one used here just to finish it out. Nope, throws them both out. Never mind. Gets stuck in for 22 damage. 22 more than 12 confirmed. That is going to be lethal. And Ryzen from ours, or at least me, talking about how he may be doomed to a 0-3.
Your own teammate.
I know. I was doing it to just inspire him vicariously. Even though he can't hear me, he'd feel my negative words coming through the ether. and inspire him to pick up that win against the Druid and then finish out the Secret Paladin as well. So he's now just a Druid Mirror away from advancing to day two.
Yeah, that's, you know, is a much more interesting position for Ryzen than it was staring down potentially 2-0 down to the patron of show. You know, just has to win that Druid Mirror or to win the Druids, win the Paladin versus Druid matchup, which is definitely winnable.
Yep. You know, we saw there, Show chose to pick it over a Druid Mirror. So Show obviously feels like the Paladin's favored. I agree. I think it's slightly favored as well. We just saw Ryzen just get ahead of the draws there a little bit. And then that huge swing turn with the BGH on the Challenger turn, which is the dream answer. One of the best BGH targets in the game is a 6-6. Who figured? But it turns out that is just the case. And yeah, that huge swing is going to be the same sort of thing that Sho is going to have to look for if he's going to get through this Druid Mirror, and then if he's going to come back and defeat the Paladin from Ryzen as well. He's going to be looking for that same sort of BGH to Challenger lineup if he gets through.
Absolutely. So, predictions here, Sol. Do you think Ryzen is going to be able to take out Sho? It would be a big upset.
It would, for sure, yeah. Sho definitely has more of a storied history in tournament than Ryzen, but Ryzen, very, very accomplished player in his own right, but as I mentioned, pretty much just a full-time streamer at this point. Doesn't focus too much on competitive play, just wants to get his stream hours in. But, you know, I think he can do it. He's in a favorable position now. He has a 50-50 and probably a 45% matchup that he just has to win one of. So just purely statistically, he's in really good shape. So I'd give him a pretty damn good chance of clutching this one out. He seems to be playing well, doesn't seem to be suffering from the stream nerves or any of that sort of stuff. So I think he's in a good spot.
Yeah, I mean, I mentioned the Dingit Invitational that he played in, and I remember that being, you know, we were talking about that, as that was really his first tournament appearance. He hadn't played in any kind of Invitational tournament or stream tournament to that point. I think he ended up losing in the first round, so that wasn't the greatest performance for him
right
when that happened a few months ago. And, you know, there is a certain bit of pride, I guess, if you're a streamer coming in and wanting to prove that you are a good player. And going up against a guy like Sho, if you're able to get that win, it definitely does prove you're a good player in one fell swoop, to be honest, if you're able to take out Sho here and show some considerable skill. I just said skill, and then I was about to say Druid, and I know Twitch chat was very upset by that.
And then those two words clashed in your brain, and an explosion happened. Yes. Not compatible alarms just went off everywhere. Yeah.
Yeah, well, the winner of this match will, of course, face the winner of our next match on stream, which is one I'm very much looking forward to. It's going to be Orange versus Strifecrow.
Nice.
Kind of the new guard, the new guys versus the old guards, mm-hmm. in many ways. So that's going to be a really interesting one coming up. And then, I mean, the lineup is stacked for the rest of today. We've got Dog versus Zalay, Hoy versus Jab, Life Coach versus Purple, and Ecop versus Firebat. This tournament is insane. So. Yep.
It is. It's just name after name after name. I mean, we said it all at the start where I just went through and picked out. I think I named like 9 of the individual players, and straight away, like, you didn't even say Life Coach. I can't name. They're all amazing players. Like, I can't name everyone. So, yeah, insane game. Insane tournament, sorry. But we are just waiting for this last game to start. Not quite sure what the holdup is here, whether it's on our side or their side. Could be just one of the players wanting to take a moment. Looks like we're getting into it, and we have the riveting excitement, Callum, of a Druid Mirror.
Absolutely. Well, neither of them have drawn Wild Growth in the Mulligan to start with, so no one's won yet.
Yeah.
We'll see if any of them can Mulligan into it. I mean, the good thing for Sho is if he does lose, he can blame Dignitas, I think. You know, that was Dignitas' Sho, so.
And this is
taking blame. And
it's an interesting.
Well, there's the Wild Growth. There you go.
Okay, so Sho hit the Wild Growth. Looks like Ryzen didn't. Ryzen did choose to keep a Shredder, which is an interesting decision always in Druid Mulligan, because having a Shredder in your hand makes 4 cards really good that you're mulliganing 3 spots in your hand for. So you're mulliganing 3 spots to hit Innovate, Wild Growth, or Wild Growth. All of those cards then make that Shredder that you kept incredibly powerful. But you can also just allocate that one extra slot that you kept the Shredder into one more slot to potentially hit one of those 4 cards. So it's always a tough decision whether or not to keep the Shredder. Ryzen definitely chooses to go for it here and doesn't pick up the Wild Growth to go with it. Sho, on the other hand, does hit it. Going to curve out naturally to the Shredder next turn.
I just... Ryzen was mousing over the Wrath there.
Right, yeah.
Was he thinking of... I mean, we talked about two cute plays earlier on, right? Was he thinking about Wrathing his own 1-1 potentially? But yeah, we're just going to see the Shredder from show.
I think more than likely it may have just been an Innovate bluff, trying to put the seed of Innovate in your opponent's mind, that he's touching a card on turn two in this situation. He might be considering an Innovate play. Seems
Does
unlikely.
That work?
Okay, so there was a player in the PGL tournament that's going on as well that was doing that every single turn, like touching multiple cards and weird stuff, but like none of his actions were convincing. He wasn't touching cards in a way that a player actually does touch cards while they consider what to play. So by just like bluffing badly, he was giving away more information than just touching nothing. So I thought the whole thing was ridiculous, but some well-placed bluffs can actually get the job done. I know Hoy is the person I will default to on all this kind of stuff, because I think he is the king of mind games in Hearthstone at this point. He definitely understands the power of trying to get into your opponent's head every now and again. But like mainly, I just don't see why Ryzen would be genuinely considering playing Wrath.
Well, we'll see Hoy later on, of course, going up against Jab. But right now, it's Ryzen versus Sho. And Sho is definitely getting the better of this in the early going. Curving out very well indeed with the wild growth into the Shredder, the Druid of the Claw, and has the Thorsten and the Drake to go as well.
Yeah.
But there's Sylvanas for Ryzen.
Yeah, Sylvanas could actually be a big card here, but it's just a matter of how much pressure is in play. Like, can Sho get far enough ahead where he doesn't have to interact with the Sylvanas anymore? Can he just push face and let Ryzen have to work it out and just threaten too much damage that way? But we'll see. Looks like Emperor is the play here. Could choose to work in the hero power with the Piloted Shredder to take care of one of these 1-1s, but unless he's particularly scared of Savage Roar, I would imagine that Mr. Thorasan comes down here.
Yeah, I mean, when you can hit part of the combo and some great utility minions like Shredder and Drake, it's only four cards you're hitting, but it's still a pretty great Thorasan card.
It is, yeah. The Drake down to 3 mana means that a swipe draw next turn or off the Drake being played will be able to be used. Does respect the state of the board enough to trade, though. Realizes that Savage Roar on 4 minions here would be a backbreaking play just in terms of board control. So chooses to respect the board, trades, realizes he's a little bit behind in the race right now just in terms of life totals. Consolidates a board, needs the Emperor to be dealt with, which means Ryzen is going to have to at least allocate some mana to removal this turn, since he only has 4 power on board. So the trade here, taking some power off the board, actually forces Ryzen to slow down anyway.
Yep, Wrath's to get some card draw. There's the Darnassus Aspirant we talked about earlier on, and was very much not what he was wanting to see in that situation.
Yeah, just drew a River Crocolis that turn. It's just not a relevant card. And if he could have actually played it there, it would have ramped him into his turn 7 Doctor Boom, but it just wouldn't have stayed alive on the board. As soon as you get past sort of turn 4 or so, you're in this position where that card just doesn't really ever seem relevant again.
I didn't really clock this at the time when we were playing the Thorsten, but the Thorsten onto the Drake and the Shredder is really good because you can play them turn 7.
You can just play them both on the same turn, yeah. And yeah. After talking about swipes, I thought he had 8 mana this turn for some reason. I just looked at the mana wrong, but...
Yeah, I was just letting you have it. Because,
okay.
You give me so much slack when I make mistakes.
Yeah, of course.
I thought I'd do the same.
I can only expect to have the favor returned. But yeah, drawing those two swipes while he does have the Drake on the board will probably have made him feel pretty good, but that Sylvanas has now come down in a situation where Sho probably can't ignore it here. It's just too dangerous. He could just lose his Shredder here for free if there's a second Wrath in the hand of Ryzen and he goes face, trade Sylvanas into the Drake, Wrath your own Sylvanas, draw a card, steal the Shredder. Just looks far too dangerous in this situation. So Sho might have to respect it, but at the same time, he doesn't really have a good line to be able to respect it either. So
this is the thing, like even if you double trade, you give away the 2-drop.
Yep.
And leave yourself with an empty board. So is Sho just going for the...
It looks like it might be the place. Is he going to go for the force? Okay, so it looks like he's going to try and get a tree stolen here, which is probably the best line. Yeah, push his face with the trees, and it looks like just trade hero power into the Sylvanas. So there's 4 options here that aren't bad. There's the 3 trees, which are great, and the 2-drop off the Shredder, which is fine as well. So this definitely looks like the right.
Oh!
Oh my god, the Drake. Ugh.
Well, that's... Yeah. That was the worst of five options.
It was.
By a long way. And that's the second time we've seen something like that. I mean, we saw the mind control tech steal the Sea Giant earlier on. Esports.
Yep. Respects the Armorsmith, obviously knows that the second force of nature, Savage Roar, would be lethal here if he left the Drake up on the board, but the swipe into Big Game Hunter play is going to clear the board up here. That kind of thing again, where we talked about investing your entire tempo, your entire turn of tempo into one minion, might have been better to do that with the Ancient of Lore that turn, strangely enough. We had that conversation earlier before about, do you play Lore or do you play Boom on turn 7, but Lore is actually strangely a lot harder to deal with for Druid than Dr. Boom. Because, you know, swipe hero power is required to kill it. It doesn't get killed by BGH, so much less chance of a tempo swing if you played the 5-5 there than the 7-7, strangely enough. Could have even just jammed Emperor. Lots of options that turn, but he chose to go with the aggressive line, which you can't blame him for too much. It always seems like Dr. Boom is a good play whenever you can drop it on a board like that, but does end up getting punished for it.
Yeah, of course, Savage Roar is lethal for Ryzen, so you can try and draw two cards this turn and set himself up for it with the Ancient of Lore. Though obviously he does know that combo is lethal on the backswing, so he needs to be aware of the potential from show. This is a very dangerous position for both players. And is there a temptation to heal if you're Ryzen, to get yourself out of combo range? I guess not, because the BGH is on the board. He's actually, he's going to Force of Nature.
Interesting. So it looks like he's evaluating his hand here and thinking that he can win this game on value as long as the combo isn't drawn by his opponent. And having seen one Force of Nature used, I guess he has the read that the combo isn't there. I guess that's a decent read to have, because you saw one Force of Nature get used already, and it was in a situation where they were kind of forced to Force of Nature, right? It wasn't like a reckless Force of Nature that they seemed to just throw out for no reason. It was a Force of Nature that had a purpose, that solved a difficult problem. So you'd expect that your opponent was forced to use that Force of Nature. They weren't just throwing it away because they had the second one in hand. So the read that there's no combo is probably pretty solid here from Ryzen. And he's just going to try and win this game on overall value here with the great cards that he has in hand. The longevity of the Lore and the Drake.
The swipe onto the Aspirant.
Yeah. Hey, River Croc tank to swipe. It's not too bad.
Yeah, feels bad for show. There's no lethal draw for either player at this position, right?
There is not, no. Sho choosing to go with the hero power there instead of the Aspirant, I guess, plays around Druid of the Claw Savage Roar from his opponent. Having now seen the Force of Nature, he's looking for alternate ways that he dies outside of the combo. Druid of the Claw Savage Roar is one of the things that can do that. That's swipe top deck, though! Oh, baby. Wow.
And he innervates the hero power, because that means that even if the Drake is cleared, if Sho doesn't hero power, then Savage Roar top deck's lethal, right?
Correct.
Because it's 3 damage, yeah. So, yeah, Sho's going to have to heal and neglect to draw, and that's going to put him behind, because all he has is Savage Roar, though a Force of Nature top deck is lethal.
Yeah, Ancient of Lore is 2 outs here to hit Savage Roar as well, which is lethal.
This is a really interesting decision for Ryzen. Do you take the 2 shots to hit Savage Roar on Ancient of Lore, or do you take the Wild Growth that if you whiff, you can then play something else?
I like this. You can Wild Growth first. Now, if you whiff, you can still play Lore and you can still hit Living Roots on 2 draws, which is not lethal. No, that's not lethal anymore because you can't hero power. I'm not sure which is the best there mathematically, actually.
Well, he Wild Growthed into Wild Growth, unfortunately.
Yeah, not probably what he was looking for. But Lotheb is a good draw. If he plays that and just trades with the Aspirant, then just Savage Roar from his opponent is... Well, just Swipe is not lethal. Just Savage Roar is not lethal. Nice. Yeah, this seems fair. I think if you're playing the Lotheb, you do have to trade into the 2-3, though, to respect the Savage Roar. Yeah. Seems pretty tempting to go face when you're so close to lethal, but this seems right.
This is a real nail-biter of a game here. There's just a couple of draws that could decide this game, but right now, they're on really low health, and neither of them has a way to finish the other off. Because if Sho trades the 5-5s together here and plays the Shade, there's no lethal on the backswing, right? Unless there's a Savage Roar picked up.
Yep. If he gets the hero power in as well, we're now back in the same situation where he doesn't have the wild growths anymore, so he probably will just play Ancient of Lore to dig. But due to that one extra health being gained from the armor, he's removed a couple of cards from the equation here. He's actually just going to try and use Ancient of Lore to go long here in this game and just respect his additional value on the board, which makes a lot of sense, but still, second Force of Nature top deck here from Sho will get the job done. It's not good enough.
And he has to heal here, right?
He has to heal, he has to trade into the Drake. That's the only way he stays alive. But I don't think it's good enough overall, because
Ryzen's going to be one damage off lethal if Sho heals.
But, you know, even if he doesn't top deck lethal, he trades the 5/5s and he just plays Thorasan and Shredder. And how do you come back from that at that point? He'll be out of range of combo. He's going to Savage Roar and kill the 5/5? I guess this makes sense. Yeah, this is right. This is the only play that ever wins the game, I think.
Yeah. Oh, they have Force of Nature off the top. Didn't even get to see it coming to the hand first. And there you go. Ryzen upsetting Sho in our third match of the day. Ryzen is going to advance to our top 8 tomorrow. A big shock, Sotil.
A big shock, yeah. Obviously, I'm proud of my Complexity boys. You know, I know how good they are, but they're not players that have had the level of exposure that some of the names in this tournament have, so even I have to label that as a shock, but congrats to Ryzen. I think he played great. I think he brought a good lineup. And he's going to go through to tomorrow and is in good shape to make a big splash in this tournament.
Absolutely. Well, if he's going to advance even further in the tournament through the top 8, he's going to have to take out another big name, another player with a lot of tournament pedigree. It's going to be the winner of Orange versus Strifecrow. And that is our next match. A very exciting one. And, you know, we've had exciting matches to this point, Sotil, but I really feel from now to the end of the tournament, it's just this, you know, this is headliners all the way down. So make sure you're sticking with us for the Wombology tournament, because you're not going to see a line of players like this anywhere else right now. This lineup is absolutely sick. So any other final thoughts on that last game?
I think we actually saw you know, as much as we memed about it at the start, I think we actually saw a pretty entertaining Druid mirror there. And I think the reason for that is that we saw the combos taken out of the game. We saw Force of Nature's used by both players for board clear. We saw Savage Roars used for board control as well, one by Ryzen early, one by Sho late. So that put us in a position where we had a much more honest battle between minions and draws and etc. So I think that created a much more interesting scenario between the two decks. Maybe that's a hint for Standard. I don't know. Maybe. Who knows?
All right, well, we're going to go to a quick break. When we come back, as I say, it's going to be Orange versus Strifecrow in our next match. It's going to be the Seat Story 1 champion versus the Seat Story 2 champion. Did I get that right? Was it Seat Story 3? What are the others?
Strifecrow 1? Yeah, he did. Yeah, no, I think that's right. That sounds right. Yeah. Let's go with
that. There you go.
Sure.
Two very decorated players, a North America versus EU clash. Whatever way you want to get excited about this, get excited. Arkham versus Cloud9, whatever. Be back here in just a few minutes. You're watching the Wombology Tournament here on Twitch.